Can you run Discord, trade crypto, or use Visual Studio Code on an old Windows 2000 computer? Surprisingly, it's somewhat possible. We are going to craft a special version of Windows 2000 that works on older machines and test out what modern tasks it can handle. Welcome to Decode. We'll start in just a few seconds. Before we go further, please note that this is educational and for entertainment purposes. We are delving into an outdated version of Windows that Microsoft no longer supports, making it prone to security risks and more attractive to hackers. Additionally, we'll be using community-created patches and browsers that could have their own security flaws. So, if you decide to try this by yourself, be aware that it's very risky and not secure. We are going to set up Windows 2000, then apply both official and unofficial updates. Next, we'll install the new Moon browser, which is currently the best option for this operating system, and we'll finally visit some popular websites that people use daily to see if Windows 2000 still can handle basic everyday tasks. Let's begin with the setup. We are using the official disk image of Windows 2000 Service Pack 4 and running it in VirtualBox, a virtualization software. Although I'm demonstrating this on a virtual machine, I performed these steps on an actual Pentium 4 hardware last year with similar results. The installation process is automated, known as an unattended setup. VirtualBox automates this by creating a floppy disk image that contains a file with the serial key and configuration settings. The Windows installer reads this floppy automatically and uses it to streamline the installation process. After Windows 2000 is installed, the next step is to install the necessary drivers. For me, this means installing the VirtualBox guest editions. These additions enable better graphics support and video acceleration, among other enhancements. Once the drivers are in place, I'll personalize the look of the operating system a little. I'll apply my own theme and adjust the screen resolution and the scaling settings. Our Windows 2000 setup is nearly finished. Next, we'll install both official and some extra updates to help the system run more recent software. First, we'll install 7-zip, which is necessary for unpacking archive files. It's a handy tool, and the latest version still officially supports Windows 2000. Once it's installed, I'll set it up to work with the File Explorer and handle archive files directly. Next, we'll install Windows 2000 Update Rollup 1. This official update package contains many smaller updates all in one. After installing it, we'll need to restart the system. The third step in updating our Windows 2000 system is to install the Windows Installer update. Just like before, the process is straightforward and will also require a system reboot once complete. Next, we'll need to install Internet Explorer 6 Service Pack 1, which again necessitates the restart of the computer. The final update is an unofficial patch known as the Extended Kernel by Blackwing Cat, which is available on their official website. Once we've downloaded the file, we use the 7-zip we installed earlier to extract it. Then, we open the folder and run the setup.cmd file. This will apply some additional patches and prompt us to manually restart the computer. After the restart, we return to the folder we extracted the files, navigate to the update subfolder, and run the update exe application. Following this last update, we restart the computer one more time. To confirm that the extended kernel is installed, we open the Windows folder and run the nnn4nt5.exe file. We need to apply the Windows XP Service Pack 3 configuration here to make future applications believe they are running on XP. This might alter the About Windows dialog displaying Service Pack 3 or an incorrect Windows version, but this is expected and nothing to worry about. Lastly, we'll need to install the new Moon browser, a version of Pale Moon designed for Windows XP. I will download the most recent 32-bit version. After downloading, I'll simply extract the files from the archive and run the palemoon.exe file to get started. So all the updates are applied and we can finally start testing what modern everyday websites or web apps this 1999 system still supports. We'll begin by testing a few common websites. First up is Discord. When I open the Discord website, it appears to work quite well, which is a surprise. I'll click on the login button and scan the QR code with my phone. I must emphasize once more that logging into your personal accounts on this outdated and insecure system is not advisable. After scanning the QR code, I'm logged in and everything seems to function properly, except for the voice chat, which unfortunately doesn't work. Next, we'll check out YouTube. I'll attempt to open a channel and see if watching a video is possible. The video playback works, but the New Moon browser has some difficulty with the complex nature of this site. To really test its capabilities, I'll try playing a video at its original quality of 2K resolution at 60 frames per second. It's a bit of a struggle, but it manages to play smoothly in the end. Keep in mind, if you try this on actual old hardware, the performance might be worse due to the older GPU, which wouldn't be as capable as the one emulated by VirtualBox. It's quite unexpected, but YouTube Studio also functions properly. This means that I can attempt to upload a video from the Windows 2000 computer. Let's go ahead and try uploading a sample video. The video is small, so it uploads quickly. I'll now open the video link to check if it's ready for viewing. After a second try, I'm able to watch the video I just uploaded, all from this very old operating system. Now, let's try Twitter. It seems to function almost properly and all of the main functions are still working fine. I recall I tried to tweet from the real hardware with the same OS a year ago, so I assume that this still works. Let's also see if Reddit is accessible. Similar to the other websites we visited, it appears to be functioning well. Instagram is also operational, so you can even post photos from your Windows 2000 computer. Modern office software is another daily tool for many, so let's try using Google Docs. Despite a warning that the browser isn't supported, Google Docs still functions properly, allowing us to edit text just as we would on a current version of Windows. Now let's try to use more complex and more specific applications. We'll attempt to use Visual Studio Code on Windows 2000. Since Visual Studio Code can operate as a web application, it's theoretically possible to run it in a browser, which means that the modern IDE can, to some extent, work on this old operating system. However, it's not fully functional because, as a web application, it doesn't have proper access to the local file system, so you can't open a local workspace directly. Despite this, it can still be used as a basic text editor to open and edit individual files. When we open a sample C++ code file, it renders the text and applies syntax highlighting correctly. In theory, this setup could also serve as a frontend to a Visual Studio Code server hosted on another machine. Although, when I tried using GitHub CodeSpaces, it was unable to connect to the remote server. Now we're going to see if we can use modern AI, specifically ChatGPT-4, on Windows 2000. It does indeed open, so I'll take a screenshot and ask ChatGPT what it thinks about the current situation. Initially, the AI suspects that the screenshot might be fabricated. To clarify, I'll inform GPT-4 that this is a genuine Windows 2000 setup that has been updated with various patches. GPT-4 then appears to be quite impressed by the effort put in by the creators of these patches. Let's try to use something even more complex. Let's see if we can analyze the crypto or stock market on Windows 2000. We are going to use TradingView, which is a really complex software. You can see tons of the data on the page and some impressively complex graphs. Since this browser is unstable, it just crashed. But after restarting it again, everything seems to work just fine, and this huge complex website seems to function. This made me curious about whether it's possible to trade cryptocurrency on Windows 2000. I decided to give it a shot and buy some Bitcoin on Binance. After opening Binance and logging in with the QR code, I discovered I had $13 in my account. I transferred this to my spot trading account and placed a market buy order. It went through successfully. I was able to buy Bitcoin with my $13. Then I sold the Bitcoin and got my $13 back. So it turns out you can indeed trade crypto on Windows 2000. So this is it for this video. Please like the video and subscribe to the channel. Buy me a coffee or join my Patreon to support the channel so that I can make more videos. And drop a comment below if you have any thoughts on this.